By covering the basics of TV diagrams in our previous two lecture videos, link below if you haven't watched those already, we mostly cover the case where piston cylinder systems maintained a constant pressure by allowing the fluid inside them to change both temperature and volume. Today we'll focus on heating at a constant volume, and with the differences between that and heating at a constant pressure, introduce the concepts of enthalpy and internal energy. These two are related to, and pretty commonly used with, constant pressure and constant volume processes. An example of a constant volume process can be as simple as an Instapot or other types of pressure cookers. We can have a rigid tank that prevents its contents from increasing or decreasing volume. We can have some liquid water in there with a little bit of it already being vapor, and we can add heat to it, making some or all of the liquid water become vapor. This would be the case of heating at a constant volume, since the total volume of H2O inside the tank is the volume of the tank itself. And it doesn't matter if the final state is a new state of saturated liquid vapor or simply no liquid water, meaning either saturated vapor or superheated. If we look at the TV diagram of what we had been doing so far with piston cylinder systems, we were adding or removing heat to change temperature and volumes, while the pressure was kept the same. And we could have those processes for higher or lower pressures. In this case, where we begin with liquid vapor water at a certain pressure, we'd be somewhere between saturated liquid and saturated vapor. It means that we could also either determine or be given the quality of the mixture. If we're now adding heat to bring up the temperature without changing the volume, because again it's a rigid container, we would be going straight up and up only. Constant specific volume, because neither the volume nor the mass is changing, while the temperature is indeed increasing. And of course, we would be going from pressure 1 to pressure 2, where pressure 2 is higher. We can keep adding heat to reach state 3 or even state 4, always on the same volume value and only increasing the pressure. Now for this simple example of a pressure cooker being used to raise the temperature of water, what is happening in terms of the first law, or in other words, in terms of conservation of energy? There is no kinetic energy nor a change in potential energy. And since our volume is the same in 1 and 2, the work is also 0. This means that the change in internal energy is equal to the heat, or in other words, that the heat transfer is what causes the change in internal energy. Without explicitly pointing it out, we had already seen this in previous examples. For instance, when we compare the electric versus gas water heaters, link below to that problem, we were stating that the heat coming out of burning the gas was becoming energy to change the temperature of the water in the heater's tank. And even before then, with some of the examples for reviewing specific heat for liquids and solids, we were stating that the heat Q was equal to the mass times specific heat times the change in temperature. In these two examples and some others we've used to practice some of the concepts we've covered so far, we skipped the step where we used the first law to say that the heat is equal to the change in internal energy, because there's no other types of energy present, to therefore state that Q is mc delta T. But what is really happening is that delta U is mc delta T. More on this later when we cover specific heats, link below. For now, this change in internal energy can be written as capital U2 minus U1 for whatever amount of mass we have, meaning this is an extensive property, or we can write the change in internal energy as lowercase u2 minus u1 times the mass. Lowercase u's would be intensive properties. You already knew that, but this is just a reminder. We'll see that lowercase u is a property that depends on the temperature, so if the temperature changes, we can look up how much the specific internal energy u changes. So for now, we'll forget about that review of specific heat that we apply to liquids and solids, and just go to property tables to find specific internal energy values for a given temperature and pressure. Now, what happens if we use the conservation of energy equation, just like we did for the rigid tank, but this time for a piston cylinder system? We already knew that if we have a piston cylinder system with vapor in it, and we add heat to it, the volume inside the system will expand, since the pressure inside and outside the piston should be the same. So this expansion happens at a constant pressure. From conservation of energy, we can neglect the changes in kinetic energy and potential energy, but now we cannot say that the work is zero, because the volume is indeed changing here. We calculated the work in terms of pressure and volume in the efficiency in thermodynamic systems lecture, link below if you don't remember. We stated that the work is the integral of PdV. And since the pressure here is constant, the pressure comes out of the integral, and that integral becomes V2 minus V1. In the case of a rigid tank at constant volume, we just concluded that the heat transfer was equal to the change in internal energy. In this case, the heat transferred must be equal to the change in internal energy plus the PV terms. Rearranging the values here, we see that what describes the state at 2 and the state at 1 are the same two terms, and this combination of internal energy and P times V is so common in so many applications that this is what we call enthalpy. Therefore, Q is equal to capital H2 minus capital H1, where capital H, or enthalpy, is equal to the specific enthalpy times the mass. In general, enthalpy reflects the capacity to release or gain heat while doing non-mechanical work. In the property tables 13-minute lecture, link below, we went over how these tables have all the intensive properties we will need for any thermodynamic process, including specific internal energy U in kilojoules per kilogram, specific enthalpy H in kilojoules per kilogram as well, and specific entropy S in kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. What this means is that, for example, if we are in a saturated mixture phase, and just like with the specific volumes VF and VG, these tables will show us UF and HF for the internal energy and the enthalpy of saturated liquids, and UG and HG for the internal energy and enthalpy of saturated vapor. The way we use these is exactly the same as how we use the specific volume for saturated liquid and the specific volume for saturated vapor. The expression we derived in the previous lecture for quality, link below, is also applicable for these two properties. From what we did today, we know that the specific internal energy U is related to heating at constant volume, and that the specific enthalpy is related to heating at a constant pressure. We'll get to entropy a bit later in the course, but for now, know that you can find those values from the tables that we already learned how to use. Let's see how all of this is applicable with a simple example, and if you'd like to see some more complex examples where everything you need to know is covered, make sure to check out the links found in the description of this video. A closed and rigid tank has a volume of 0.6 cubic meters and contains a two-phase mixture of liquid water and vapor at 1 bar with a quality of 0.7. If we add heat so that the pressure rises to 1.25 bar, what are the initial temperature, the final temperature, and the specific heat transferred during the process? As always, remember to try this problem on your own before watching the solution. Since the problem is already telling us that there's a two-phase mixture of liquid and vapor, or just from the fact that we have a quality value, we know that what we have in the tank is a saturated liquid-vapor phase. Therefore, the temperature must be the saturation temperature for 1 bar. We look this up through any of the online tools or by going to the saturated table, pression version, and for 1 bar, we find that the saturation temperature is 99.61 degrees Celsius. By adding heat, what we'll do to this mixture in a rigid tank that cannot change its volume is going straight up, like we previously explained. So if we know V1, we know V2, and this is useful because with V2 and P2, we can find T2, the second question. And by the way, I don't mean any ideal gas equation calculations, if you're thinking about that. With the quality expression we derived in the previous 9-minute lecture video, link below, and by looking up the values for VF and VG for 1 bar, we can find that the specific volume is 1.186, and this is the specific volume for before adding heat and after adding heat. Now, this second state can be inside the dome and therefore the water is still a saturated mixture, or outside the dome and the water is superheated. To find out, we look up VG for P2, and since the specific volume after adding heat is lower than the specific volume for a saturated vapor at that pressure, we conclude that the water is still a saturated mixture, and therefore T2 is the saturation temperature for P2. Looking this up, we find 105.97 degrees Celsius. Now, what about our last question? How much heat did we transfer? From our first law, or energy conservation equation, we know that there was no work or changes in kinetic or potential energy. This means that Q is the change in internal energy, U2 minus U1, or the mass times the change in specific internal energy, U2 minus U1. This also means that lowercase q is just U2 minus U1. The specific internal energies U1 and U2 can be found if we have the quality X1 and X2, and the saturated specific internal energies UF and UG for both pressure values. X1 we have, and UF and UG can be found from the table at 1 bar. This means we have U1. For U2, we can also find UF and UG from the table at 1.25 bar, with the difference being that we don't know what the quality is at that higher pressure. Since we already know that the process happened at a constant specific volume, V2 is equal to V1. And with VF and VG for that pressure, and the same expression for quality, although rearranged, we can solve for X2 and find it to be 0.863. Now, knowing the quality of the mixture after adding the heat X2, we can calculate U2, and with U2, the total specific heat transfer. And that's it. If we had been asked the total heat transfer, we would multiply this by mass. Which, by the way, we can easily find since we have the total volume and the specific volume. If you want to check out more complex examples, for instance the case where the added heat brings the water to a superheated state, and we then need to use the superheated tables to find T2 and the heat transfer, or some examples where the pressure is maintained constant instead of the volume, meaning we need to look up enthalpy values instead of internal energy, make sure to check out the links in the description of this video. You'll find more examples, the other lectures for the thermo course, and other engineering courses. Thanks for watching!